So once we'll have a what we have done there in our previous class. In our previous class, we discussed about the shapes of the orbitals. In our previous
orbitals.
Class, we discussed about the shapes of the orbital. See, as I told you, as orbital is spherical and non-directional, what does it mean? Means if you'll change the direction of the s orbital, then also there will not be any change in the properties. See, what orbital is? P orbital is double shaped, that is directional. If we'll change the direction of the P orbital, their properties will get changed. This is x-axis, so this will be Px, and if this is y-axis, then this will be Py, and if this is z-axis, then this will be Pz. So change in direction, there will be change in the properties. This is what the meaning of directional is. Now see what is d orbital. D orbital is double dumbbell shaped. D orbital is double dumbbell shaped. That is directional. If we'll change the direction of the d orbitals, there will be change in the properties. Now we know d is having 5 orbitals. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Dxy, dxy. This is dxy.
Dyz.
Dxy. This is dxy. Dxy. This is dyz. I'll write it again. We'll be taking 5 d orbitals. 5 d orbitals. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is dxy. This is dxy. I don't know why. This is dy. This is dyz. This is dxz. Dx square y square. And this is dz square.
See,
5d orbitals are there, namely dyz, dxy, dxz, and dx square, y square, and dz square. See, if we'll take this as x, if we'll take this as x and y axis, between x and y axis, then it will be known as dxy. But if it is along the axis, but if it is along the x and y axis, then it will be dx square y square. Are you got the point? If between
yes.
The axis, then dxy. Between the x and y axis, dxy. But along the x and y axis, then it will be dx square y square. See,
y square.
This is y, this is z. Between the y and z axis, then it will be dyz. If it is this is x and this one is z, and between x and z axis, then it will be dxz.
Dxz.
Now, if we'll take this as z axis, then this will be along the z axis and around the nucleus. In around the nucleus, they are in x and y axis. Around the nucleus, they are in x, y axis, and
one
on the z axis. Then it will be dz square.
Dz square.
Dz square, m value will always be zero, that I told you. And dxy and dx square, y square. Dxy and dx square, y square, this will either be having plus 2 or will be having minus 2. If this is plus 2, this will be minus 2. And if this is minus 2, this will be plus 2. What about these two, xz and yz? One will be having plus 1 and second will be having minus. If this is minus 1, this will be plus 1. And this is plus 1, this will be minus 1. So this is all about the shapes of the d orbitals. Here, dxy. Dxy, fine. Now see, we'll go to the shape of the arrow f orbitals that we already discussed. See, this point is very important. Just remember this. Dz square, two lobes along z axis only, and ring of negative charge surrounding nucleus in xy plane. That is important. In xy plane, it will be there surrounding the nucleus. That will be the ring of negatively charged. Fine. So what about the shape of the f orbital? The shape of that f orbital is this. Scientists even do not know. So that's why we can't say anything about the shape of the f orbital.
F orbital.
What next is? Next is quantum bus. See, this is very important and difficult to see. Your vehicle is having GJ, suppose CO4, MN, 4121. Suppose this is your vehicle number.
Yes.
Here also four things, 1, 2, 3, 4. In quantum number also four things are there. You can classify quantum number into four classes, like it here. This is a state. This is a state. This is what? City. This is what? Year of manufacturing, and this is what serial number in that year is. So as the vehicle's registration number, you can come to know about the state of your vehicle, we can come to know about the city of your vehicle, we can come to know about the year of manufacturing, whether it is your 2020 model or 2015 model or 2010 model. From this you will come to know. Those who are there, they're in automobile, into automobiles business. If you'll tell them your vehicle's number, na, from there they will tell you how much price they will be paying you for your vehicle, because they know which model it is, which year model it is, which place. If it is coastal area, then the price resale value of that vehicle will be very, very less because of saline air, na. Engine in that much good condition. So coastal areas there, if it is Delhi vehicle, then you will get a good price. But if it is Bombay vehicle, then they will be giving you very, very less price. So from their number, from their your vehicle's registration number, they can come to know easily how much revaluation value of your vehicle is there. So as these four numbers gives you information about your vehicle, like that quantum number gives you information about the electron. Quantum numbers as this registration number gives an idea about your vehicle, like that quantum numbers are the code numbers which gives us information about the electron. What information this quantum number carries? This quantum number carries 9 points. 9 points it carries. See, your home is made of
brick, cement.
No, your home is made of rooms. Fine. Okay. Rooms are made of, now you'll be giving me the right answer, because you know in which direction I am going. Your rooms are made of walls.
Yeah.
And walls are made of
what? Okay, now they are made of
cement. Fine. What we are saying, homes are made of bricks and cement. No. Fine. Like that.
Yes.
Orbits are made of subshells. Subshells are made of subshells. That is orbitals.
Okay.
And then orbitals are comprised of electrons. What we used to say that orbits are made of electrons. No, orbits are made of subshells. S subshell, P subshell, D subshell, F subshell. And then these subshells are made of sub shells that is called orbitals.
And orbitals
are containing electrons.
Electron.
Fine. That's the point.
Yes, sir.
Now see, like that, quantum numbers are also four types. Quantum numbers are of also four types.
Four types.
One is principal quantum number. Second is azimuthal quantum number. Third is magnetic quantum number. And fourth is spin quantum number. This we will do there in coming topics. Fine. So you can classify quantum numbers into four classes. Principal quantum number, azimuthal quantum number, magnetic quantum number, and spin quantum number. This gives you idea about orbit. From principal quantum number, what you will come to know about an electron? Its orbit.
Orbit.
Orbit it is there. Azimuthal quantum numbers tell you about the subshell. In which subshell that electron is there. Whether it is there in S subshell or in P subshell or in D subshell or in F subshell. That idea will become azimuthal quantum number. Magnetic quantum number tells you about the orbital. Which orbital it is. Dxy, dyz, dxz, dx square, y square or dz square. And in that orbital, two electrons are there. And you are talking about which electron that you will come to know about. That you will come to know from spin quantum number. So these quantum numbers gives you information about orbit, subshell, orbital, and electron. Fine?
Yes. Yes,
sir. Quantum numbers gives you 9 points. Quantum numbers gives you 9 information about an electron. Principal quantum number tells you 5 points about an electron. What these 5 points are, I'll tell you. From principal quantum numbers, how much information you will be getting about an electron? You will be getting 5 points related to an electron. Through azimuthal quantum number, how many points you will come to know about an electron? 2 points.
Subshell.
Magnetic quantum number will give you 1 information about an electron. And a spin quantum number gives you 1 information about it. So total how many points with the help of quantum number you can say about an electron?
9 points.
9. 5 plus 2, 7 plus 1, 8 plus 1, 9. So quantum number gives you 9 points, 9 information about an electron. What
electron.
These 9 points are? What these 9 points are which you come to know about an electron with the help of these quantum numbers. What these 9 points are? See, energy of the electron, distance of the electron from the nucleus, radii of the orbit, volume of the orbital, and energy of electron. What points you will come to know with the help of principal quantum number about an electron? Energy of the electron, energy of the
electron,
radii of the orbit, distance
of electron,
distance of electron from nucleus, volume of the orbital, and number of shell in which electron is there. Which electron is there. These 5 points you can come to know about an electron with the help of this principal quantum number. Fine? Principal quantum number tells you about the energy of the electron, radii of the orbit, distance of the electron from the nucleus, volume of the orbital, and number of shell in which electron is there. These are the 5 points. Next 2 points. These are five points. What next is 2 points. What these 2 points are? Shape of the subshell. And angular momentum of an electron.
Electron.
Now, this 1 point, what it is? Orientation of the electron. What is the meaning of orientation? Orientation means electron is there in dxy, dyz, dxz, dx square, y square, or dz square. In which orbital electron is there? That is what the meaning of orientation of electron is. See what I told you, 5 points, 2 points, 1 point, 1 point. So 5 points, 2 point, 1 point, and 1 point is last point is spin of electron. See, with the help of quantum numbers, you can say about the energy of the electrons, distance of the electron from the nucleus, volume of the orbital, radii of the orbit, and number of shell in which electron is there, angular momentum of the electron and shape of the subshell, orientation of the electron and spin of the electron. These 9 points you can come to know about the about an electron with the help of quantum numbers. Fine, these 9 points are written here. Quantum numbers are the code numbers for an electron, which tells us about the energy of the electron, orientation and spin of the electron, distance of the electron from the nucleus, volume of the orbital, radius of orbit, shape of the subshell in which electron is present. Specify orbital angular momentum, size of energy level can also be determined by all these quantum numbers. Fine. So these 9 points,
yes, we
know, and in this order only, in which order I have written here. Fine. That order you should follow, 5 plus 2 plus 1 plus 1. So total 9 points, you can, 9 properties you can come to know with the help of quantum numbers about an electron. Fine. Now see this point. See this point, that Bohr model introduced a simple quantum number n, that is principal quantum number, to describe about an electron. Principal quantum number is denoted by n, azimuthal quantum number denoted by l, magnetic quantum number is denoted by m, and spin quantum number is denoted by s. So that is what they are saying. Bohr model introduced a simple quantum number small n, that is principal quantum number, to describe an orbit. That is what I have written. This tells you about an orbit. Fine. The quantum mechanical model uses 3 quantum numbers, n, l, and m. These 3 quantum numbers, this one, and this one, n, l, m, this quantum number, these 3 quantum numbers are used by quantum mechanical model. Quantum mechanical model uses principal, azimuthal, and magnetic quantum numbers to describe an orbital. Now, okay, there are the results of Schrödinger wave equation, and each electron in an orbital is identified by its spin quantum number. Schrödinger wave mechanical model, Schrödinger wave equation says about the spin quantum number of the electron. And it was Bohr-Sommerfeld model which characterized by all the 4 quantum numbers. It is Bohr-Sommerfeld model which tells you about all the 4 quantum numbers. Schrödinger wave equation says about the spin quantum number only. Quantum mechanical model says about 3 quantum numbers, principal, azimuthal, and magnetic quantum number. And Bohr's atomic model was introduced. Bohr's atomic model introduced only a single quantum number, that is principal quantum number. So all these points we should know. Fine, all these are questions. Now we'll discuss about the all the 4 quantum numbers one by one. Now see, as I already told you, principal quantum number gives an idea about the energy of the electron, distance of the electron from the nucleus, number of shell in which electron is present, volume of the orbital and radius of the orbital, and size of energy level, that is number of shell also. This principal quantum number, is denoted by a small n, and this principal quantum number was given by Bohr. Fine. And what's the radius for H atom according to this formula? Because here you have said, no, radius of the orbit can be calculated with the help of principal quantum number. So radius for the nth shell for hydrogen atom is 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught into n square h square upon 4 me square h me square pi square. See what epsilon naught is. Epsilon naught is permittivity factor, permittivity constant. More the number of radii, more the value of radii, higher will be the number of shell.
bigger the number of shell, more will be the radii of that shell. So Rn, Rn is the radii of nth shell, and what n is number of shell. And what this 4 pi epsilon naught, as I was telling, is permittivity factor. What's the value of epsilon naught is 8.854 into 10 to the power minus 12 coulomb square kg inverse meter inverse cube second square. This is for radii of nth shell for hydrogen atom. Now the energy of the nth shell. Energy of the nth shell is 2 pi square. Energy of the nth shell is 2 pi square me to the power 4 upon pi 4 pi epsilon naught whole square n square h square. Here, energy of the shell is inversely proportional to n square. Bigger the number of shell, higher the number of shell, lesser will be the energy. Lesser will be the energy there in negative, but higher in terms of positive. As you increase the number of shell, see first shell, second shell, third shell, fourth shell, this will be having maximum energy. This will be having maximum energy in terms of positive energy. And the shell which is there at infinity will be having zero energy. So what does it mean? It means shells which are closer to infinity, which will be having lesser number than infinity, will be having energy in negative. Negative electronic energy. Electronic energy will always be considered as negative. Why?
Negative.
Because when electron will be there at infinity, that electron will be having zero energy. When electron will be there at infinity, the energy of that electron will be zero. And that will be the most stable. And as it comes closer to the nucleus, its energy start decreasing. So energy start decreasing means energy lesser than zero. Energy lesser than zero will be minus. Energy lesser than zero will be minus. That is why electronic energy will be considered as the negative energy. And the electron which is most distant from the nucleus will be having highest positive energy, but in minus it will be minimum. So this is what the energy of the shell or energy of the orbit is. Now see, if we'll see the energy of the nth shell, that will be minus 21.77 into 10 to the power minus 22 divided by n square kilojoule per atom. And if you'll be writing the same value there in the electron volt per atom, it will be minus 13.7 upon n square. And if you'll be writing the same energy of the nth shell there in kilojoule per mole, then it will be minus 1.312 into 10 to the power 3 upon n square kilojoule per mole. Fine, kilojoule per mole.
Yes.
Now see, energy of the first shell for hydrogen atom, that is E1 for H, will always be minus 13.7 electron volts per atom. Or E2 for H will always be minus 13.7 upon 4. That is equal to minus 3.425 electron volts per atom. As the distance of the electron from the nucleus increases, energy of electron also increases. That is what I was saying to you. When electron will be there at infinity, that will be having the highest energy, and that what highest energy is zero. And as you come closer to the nucleus, with the decrease in number of shells, energy of the electrons decreases. Energy of the electron decreases. Decreases means less than zero. Less than zero because highest is zero. Less than zero will always be minus. So that is why electronic energy is considered as negative energy. So this was all about the energy and radius of the electron, which you can calculate with the help of this principal quantum number. Now see, what next is principal, after this principal quantum number, next is azimuthal quantum number, or subsidiary quantum number, or angular momentum quantum number. Azimuthal quantum number, or subsidiary quantum number, or angular momentum quantum number, that's the second type of quantum number. This was denoted by L, this was denoted by small l, and this was given by Sommerfeld. It accounts for the appearance of groups of closely packed spectral lines in electric field and the shape of subshell and orbital, shape of subshell and the orbital angular momentum of the electron. This we can come to know from the azimuthal quantum number about an electron. Here, as you have said, L is equal to L is the azimuthal or subsidiary or angular momentum quantum number. So L will be equal to n minus 1. And here the value of n should always be less than or equal to 4. N value can never be greater than 4. If it is greater than 4, then this formula will become wrong. So L is equal to n minus 1, where n will always be less than or equal to 4. And this value of L can be 1, 0, 1, 2, and 3. For S subshell, S will always be 0. For P subshell, L will always be equal to 1. For D subshell, L will always be equal to 2. For F subshell, L will always be given as 3. Fine. It's a code number sort of thing. For you, it is 0. For your elder brother, it is 1. For next one, it is 2. So eldest one will be like that it is. So these codes they have given for S, P, D, F subshell. These are L values or these are the designation for subshells. For S, it is 0. For P, it is 1. For D, it is 2. And for L, F, it is 3. So these are the different values given, this different codes given for subshells, S, P, D, F subshell. Now see, as you have said, that orbital angular momentum and the shape of the subshell can be calculated with the help of this azimuthal or subsidiary or angular momentum quantum number. Now see, what's the formula for orbital angular momentum is h upon 2 pi into square root of L into L plus 1. This is what the formula for orbital angular momentum. This I already told you, L is equal to 0 for S, 1 is for P, 2 for D, and 3 is for F subshell. What's the meaning of S? S stands for sharp, P stands for principal, D stands for diffused, and F stands for fundamental. What the meaning of S? S means sigma. What the meaning of P? Pi. What the meaning of D? Delta. What the meaning of F is phi. So this S, P, D, F is in English, and in Latin, it is sigma, pi, delta, phi. This designation they have to S, P, D, F subshells. S, sigma, sharp, P, principal, pi, D, diffused, delta, F, phi, fundamental. So these are S, P, D, F subshell. See, the energy of the F subshell is maximum, and energy of the S subshell, they are in the same shell. Are you getting my point? You can't compare 1s with 2p. You can't compare 2p with 3d. You can't compare 3d, 4f. If you want to compare SPDF, then it should be 4s, 4p, 4d, and 4f. Then only this F will be having maximum energy and S will be having minimum energy.
Minimum energy.
Fine. So now next is angular momentum. Next is angular momentum.
Angular momentum
is equal to moment of inertia into angular velocity.
Velocity.
Fine. And this formula is already done. L is equal to n minus 1. N will always be less than or equal to 4. Then only
less
this.
Less than 4.
Correct. Otherwise, this won't be correct.
Correct.
Now, see. Now, see how they can ask you questions from these two quantum numbers. Now, see. If they have given 4p. If they have given 4p and they have given 3s. So here n is equal to 4 and L is equal to 1. N is equal to 4 and L is equal to 1. Because for p subshell, L value is 1. And since it is in fourth shell, so n value is 4. Now 3s. Here n value is 3 and L value is 0.
0.
So these are the n and L values of 4p and 3s. Now see, if they'll be asking you 4p and 3d, or I'll be taking different, 5p and 4d. N is equal to 5, L is equal to 1. So it will be, plus L will be 6. Here, N is equal to 4 and L is equal to 2. So total also 4, which will be having higher energy, because N plus L value gives you an idea about the energy. Higher the n plus l value, more will be the energy. Higher the n plus l value, higher the sum of n and l value, more will be the energy of that subshell. So from that point of view, you see, 4p and 3s, 4p is having value 5 and 3s will be having value 3. So 5 will be higher value, so 4p will be having higher energy and 3s will be having lesser value. So electron first goes to 3s rather than 4p. Electron will first go to 3s because this value is 3 and this value is 5. So electron will first goes to lower n plus l value, that is 3s, and then after once it is filled, then only electron will be transferred to 4p. Now see, they will be asking you in which subshell electron will go first, 5p or 4d. Here n plus l value for both is same, that is 6. So higher n value will be having higher energy and lower n value will be having lower energy. So electron will first goes to 4d, and then after that only electron will be entering into 5p. So this is the order of energy level, or you can say n plus l rule. What this was? N plus l rule. So n plus l rule will decide that electron will go in which subshell first. Lower n plus l value, there electron will be going first, and in higher n plus l value, then electron will be going after that.
After.
So this is about the n plus l rule. So all these points, all these questions which they can ask you about related to this principal quantum number and azimuthal quantum number, this is all over. Now the third quantum number, here complexity there in the questions will become more. This is little difficult one. So from here, third quantum number C. What have you said? I'll explain you this first and then we will go to the next one. C, if you have said N is equal to, if you have said N is equal to 5, what does it mean? It means L can be 0, L can be 1, L can be 2, and L can be 3. In fifth shell, all the subshells SPDF can be possible. In fifth shell, SPDF, all subshells can be possible. Is it
fine? Yes.
Now, see, if L is equal to 0, M will also be equal to 0. If L is equal to 1, M will be plus 1, minus 1 to 0, plus 2, minus. If L is equal to 2, M will be equal to plus minus 2, plus minus 1, and 0. If L is equal to 3, then M value will be plus minus 3, plus minus 2, plus minus 1, 0. Fine. Now see, what have you said? N will tell you about the number of shell. And what about the L? L is equal to N minus 1. And here N value can't be greater than or equal to, can't be greater than 4. Will either be less than 4 or will be equal to 4. Fine. So this is now. Now see what M is. M is equal to 2L plus 1. How will you calculate M value? You have to
here, L plus 1.
Here L value and then multiply it by 2 and add 1. See, for S subshell, what's the
0 M? Plus
2 into 0 will be 2 into 0 plus 1. 2 into 0 will be 0 plus 1 will be 1. What's the meaning of 1? 1 doesn't mean 1. 1 means 1 value. One means one value. What that value is? That value is 0. For P subshell. Yeah, I'll explain this again here. For P subshell, M is equal to 2 into L plus 1. 2 into L. L for P subshell is 1.
1.
1 plus 1. So 2 ones are 2.
Plus 1, 3.
3 doesn't mean 3. 3 means 3 different values. What these values are? Plus 1, minus 1, and 0.
Minus 1, 0.
Plus 1, minus 1, and 0. For PZ, M value will always be 0. And if PX is plus 1, PY will be minus 1. And if PX is minus 1, PY will be plus 1. So
plus 1.
3 doesn't mean 3. 3 means 3 different values. For D subshell, M is equal to 2 into 2 plus 1.
4 plus 1, 5.
2 is a 4 plus 1, 5. 5 doesn't mean 5. 5 means 5
values.
Plus 2, minus 2, plus 1, minus 1, and 0. And see, this you can't write like this in maths. This was then a 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Here you will be writing minus 1, minus 1, 0, plus 1, plus 2. It won't be like this. That's maths. Here we are not doing maths. According to chemistry, dxy and dx square y square will be having, if this is minus 2, then either it will be dxy or dx square y square. If y this square. Is minus 1, then either this will be dxz or dxz. If this is 0, then dz square. If this is plus 1, then plus 1 will be having dx square y dxz or dyz, and plus 2 will be either plus dxy and dx square y square. So as I already told you, xy will always be having either plus 2 or minus 2. Xz or yz will be having either minus 1 or plus 1, and dz square will be having dz square. So all these values are fixed, and we should remember this all. So in this way, you can calculate m value. In this way, you can calculate m values. So they can ask you this too. Now see what next is. Next, this magnetic contour is denoted by a small m, and this was given by Landé. It tells us about the, that's what I told you, magnetic contour number tells you about the orientation of the electron, that is position of an electron, location of an electron. And then this all is already done. See, you are drawing here all the five orbitals of D together. What does it mean? These all five orbitals are having same energy. Those orbitals which are having same energy are called degenerate orbitals. Those orbitals which are having same energy are called degenerate orbitals. Are called degenerate orbitals. Since their energy is same, so are called degenerate orbitals. Now see, splitting of spectral lines in magnetic field. Splitting of spectral lines in magnetic field is called the Zeeman effect. And splitting of a spectral line in electrical field, if it is magnetic field, then Zeeman effect. And if it is electrical field, then it will be known as Stark's effect. One is Stark and second is Zeeman. So Stark's effect means splitting of a spectral line in the electrical field. Splitting of spectral lines in the electrical field, that is called Stark effect. And if a splitting of spectral lines there in magnetic field, then it is called Zeeman's effect. Fine. Stark and Zeeman's effects are explained by magnetic quantum number. Now see, what you will come to know from the spin quantum number? From spin quantum number, you will come to know about the spin of the electron. You will come to know about the spin of the electron. See, if an electron shows clockwise spin, this electron is clockwise. So this will be denoted by plus half.
Less.
And if it is clockwise spin, then
minus half.
Plus half. And if it is anti-clockwise spin, then it will be minus half.
Minus.
S value will be minus half. So minus half means electron is showing anti-clockwise spin, this spin. And if plus half, then electron is showing clockwise.
Clockwise. Spin.
So from plus half and minus half, you will come to know about this. Now see, spin angular momentum is mvr, or it is denoted by s also, and its formula will be h upon 2 pi square root of s into s plus 1. There in orbital angular momentum, here it was l. Here it was l only, rest everything was same. H upon 2 pi into square root of s into s plus 1. But for an orbital angular momentum, instead of s, there it is l square root of l into l plus 1, and this h upon 2 pi remains as it is. So spin quantum number tells you about the spin of the electron there in an orbital, and this spin quantum number is denoted by small s, and this was given by Hollenbeck and Goldschmidt. So see from all these spin quantum numbers, you can convey so many information, so many properties, so many points related to an electron. Principal quantum number determine the approximate energy of an electron in case of multi-electron atom, but gives exact energy of electron of H atom. Maximum number of electrons in an orbit is equal to 2N square. Maximum number of maximum number of electrons in an orbit. Maximum number of electrons in an orbit is equal to 2n square, where n is equal to principal quantum number and maximum number of orbital in an orbit is n square. Now see, if they'll be asking you n, l, m and s values for valence electron of sodium. See what the valence electron of sodium is. This one, this is s1 3s1. So n is equal to 3, l is equal to 0, and if l is m will also be equal to 0, and s will be equal to either plus half
or minus half.
Any one electron is there, no? So this will be the this will be the answer. Now see, they can ask you valence electron of copper also. Valence electron of copper also. What valence also. Electron of copper is 4s1. Copper is 4s1, na? So n is equal to 4, l is equal to 0.
M is equal to
s is equal to either
plus or minus half.
Fine. This will be the answer. Now see, they can ask you one more question. One more question they can ask you. They will be giving you n is equal to 6, l is equal to 0, m is equal to 0, and s is equal to either plus half or minus half. Is the set of four quantum numbers of a valence electron of the d block element and is the only valence unpaired electron, means there is no unpaired electron, is the only valence unpaired electron. Name the element. See, they have given
6s.
N is equal to 6s. 6s1. Mm. 6s1. Mm. Now start writing electronic configuration. One s2, 2s2, 2p6, 3s2, 3p6, 4s2, 3d10, 4p6, 5s2,
4d10.
4d10, I don't know what comes after.
5p6.
So 2, 4, 10, 12, 18, 20, 30, 36, 38, 40.
6s, tak jana.
56, 7, fine. Here I'll write 5s1 because they have said 5s1 now. Now see, 2, 4, 10, 12, 18, 20, 30, 36, 38, 48, 54. 55. If I'll write like this 6s1, this will be S block element now.
Yes.
And what have they said? D block element. So what does keep on writing? So after 6s, what is there? 4f14. Now, if we'll stop here, what it will be? It will be F block element now.
Yes.
And what they are saying? It's a D block element. So keep on writing 5D. Why? 5D. Why not 5D 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9? Why only 5D 10? Because they have said that's the only valence unpaired electron. That's the only valence unpaired electron. What does it mean? It means there is no other unpaired electron. There is no unpaired electron. So we'll stop here. This is 55. 55 plus 1 will be 69, 69 plus 10 will be
79.
79 is gold, Au-79. So the name of that element is Au-79. Gold. That's why we should know the periodic table, because for such questions, they will never give you atomic number. They will never. What everybody used to say, that they will provide you atomic number, so need not to learn periodic table. They can provide you atomic number, but that will be there in numericals only, and that's also not sure that every time they'll be giving you atomic number. So if they'll be giving, then fine. If they won't be giving, then what we will do, we will again be learning next, we'll be learning next year, and we'll be waiting for the next year, no? So we should learn periodic.
Yes,
So
yes.
Theory based question, we can never expect that they will provide us the atomic number. Never.
Number.
So such questions, they will never give you atomic number. We should remember atomic number. Fine?
Yes, sir.
So so this is the reverse question. This question you will never get there in any book. In any book, you will never be getting questions like this. So that's my personal question. Just check it. So this was all about the quantum numbers. So
quantum numbers
are the code numbers for an electron, which gives us so much information about an electron. It gives an idea about the energy of the electron, distance of the electron from the nucleus, number of shell in which electron is there, volume of the orbital, and radii of the orbit. These 5 points in first part, then second part, angular momentum of the electron, and the shape of the subshell. Second part is over. Third part, orientation of the electron, that is location of an electron. And ninth, or the last point, is spin of the electron. So these 9 points you can come to know about an electron with the help of quantum numbers. So quantum numbers are the code numbers for an electron, which is carrying this all information about an electron. Is it okay?
Electron. Yes, sir.
So you should remember just to classify 5, 2, 1, 1, N, L, M, and S. Then it will be very easy for you to handle. Fine. And orbit will always be having radii, and orbital will always be having volume. Orbital is three-dimensional, na? Volume is also three-dimensional. Orbit is one-dimensional, na? Radii is also one-dimensional. So that's the way to remember this all. Now, see, we will do the next one. Atomic models. Now, what your next topic is, atomic model. Today we will do the basic one of this atomic model, and then tomorrow we'll continue the same. Fine. So now see what first point is, origin of atomic theory. Dalton was the first who gave this atomic theory, John Dalton, 1808. Tomeo is a Latin word which means divisible. Tomeo is a Latin word which means divisible. And according to your NCERT, na, before 2500 years before this Dalton, Indian sage Kannada gave this atomic theory, according to your NCERT. So Indian sage Kannada gave atomic theory, atomic hypothesis, 2500 years before Dalton. That is what it is written there in NCERT. So we should
do NCERT.
And because you have to write answers according to your NCERT, na? So what Dalton's atomic theory is, Dalton's atomic theory is, atom is hard, dense, smallest particle of matter. What atom is? Hard, dense, smallest particle of
matter. Dense, smallest particle of matter.
Atom means indivisible. Tomeo means divisible, so atom will be indivisible. Atom is a structureless, indivisible particles, can neither be created nor be destroyed during the chemical reactions, but in nuclear reactions can be destroyed or created. Now, atoms of different elements are unlike, and of same elements are alike in physical and chemical properties. Atoms of same element will be having same properties, and atoms of different elements will be having different properties compared to each other. And atoms always combine in whole number to form compounds, form a strong basis for understanding the stoichiometry, the quantitative laws of chemical combinations. So atoms always react with other atoms in a whole number ratio. It can't be there in fractional number. It can't be there in fractional number. What does it mean? Means, see, this H2 plus half O2, this reaction won't be possible. Now, what you need to write? H2 plus O2 will give you twice H2O. Here you have to write twice H2. So this won't be possible. This won't be possible. This is possible. So atom will always react with each other. They are in a whole number ratio. It can't be there. They are in the fractional number. So this was the Dalton's atomic theory. Now see, what are the drawbacks of this Dalton's atomic model? Dalton's atomic theory. Dalton's atomic theory was unable to explain why atoms of different elements. Dalton's atomic theory was unable to explain why atoms of different kinds should differ in masses and valency, etc. Different elements are having, different atoms are having, why different masses and why their valencies are different. So this Dalton's atomic model was unable to explain. This Dalton's atomic model is unable to explain structure of atom also. This Dalton's atomic theory is unable to explain binding forces between atoms in compounds. What are the type of bonding forces between the atoms there in any compound? This also Dalton's atomic model is unable to explain. Now see, this Dalton's atomic model was unable to explain Galoussek's law of gaseous volume. This Dalton's atomic model is unable to explain Galoussek's law of gaseous volume. This Dalton's law is unable to explain differentiation between differences between atoms and molecules. What differences are there between atoms and molecules? This Dalton's atomic theory is unable to explain. Discovery of isobars and isotopes showed that atoms of same elements may have different atomic masses, are called isotopes, and atoms of different kinds may have same atomic masses, that is isobars. So all these points were the drawbacks, were the defects, anomalies of Dalton's atomic model. So we should remember this all, fine? So please go through this.
Yes, sir.
This quantum number itself was very, very important and difficult topic too. So just please go through this all. Tomorrow we'll continue the same from Thomson's atomic model. Fine?
Yes, sir.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Good night.